Part 20. Arrakis teaches the attitude of the knife, chopping off what's incomplete and saying, "Now, it's complete because it's ended here." From collected sayings of Muad'Dib by the Princess Irulan. A man in Harkonnen uniform skidded to a stop at the end of the hall, stared in at Yue, taking in at a single glance Mape's body, the sprawled form of the Duke, Yue standing there. The man held a lascan in his right hand. There was a casual air of brutality about him, a sense of toughness and poise that sent a shiver through Yue. Sadaukar, Yue thought. A Bashar by the look of him. Probably one of the Emperor's own sent here to keep an eye on things. No matter what the uniform, there's no disguising them. "You are Yue," the man said. He looked speculatively at the Sook school ring on the doctor's hair, stared once at the diamond tattoo, and then met Yue's eyes. "I am Yue," the doctor said. "You can relax, Yue," the man said. "When you dropped the house shield, we came right in. Everything's under control here. Is this the Duke?" "This is the Duke." "Dead?" "Merely unconscious. I suggest you tie him." "Did you do for these others?" He glanced back down the hall where Mape's body lay. "More's the pity," Yue muttered. "Pity," the Sadaukar sneered. He advanced, looked down at Leto. "So that's the great Red Duke." If I had doubts about what this man is, that would end them, Yue thought. Only the Emperor calls the Atreides the Red Duke. The Sadaukar reached down, cut the Red Hawk insignia from Leto's uniform. "Little souvenir," he said. "Where's the ducal signet ring?" "He doesn't have it on him," Yue said. "I can see that," the Sadaukar snapped. Yue stiffened, swallowed. "If they press me, bring in a truthsayer, they'll find out about the ring, about the thopter I prepared, all will fail." Sometimes the Duke sent the ring with a messenger as surety that an order came directly from him, Yue said. "Must be damned trusted messengers," the Sadaukar muttered. "Aren't you going to tie him?" Yue ventured. "How long will he be unconscious?" "2 hours or so. I wasn't as precise with his dosage as I was for the woman and the boy." The Sadaukar spurned the Duke with his toe. This was nothing to fear even when awake. "When will the woman and boy awaken?" "About 10 minutes." "So soon?" "I was told the Baron about would arrive immediately behind his men." "So he will. You'll wait outside, Yue." He shot a hard glance at Yue. "Now." Yue glanced at Leto. "What about..." "He'll be delivered to the Baron all properly, trussed like a roast for the oven." Again, the Sadaukar looked at the diamond tattoo on Yue's forehead. "You are known. You'll be safe enough in the halls. We have no more time for chit-chat, traitor. I hear the others coming." "Traitor," Yue thought. He lowered his gaze, pressed past the Sadaukar, knowing this as a foretaste of how history would remember him. Yue the traitor. He passed more bodies on his way to the front entrance and glanced at them, fearful that one might be Paul or Jessica. All were house troopers or wore Harkonnen uniform. Harkonnen guards came alert, staring at him as he emerged from the front entrance into flame-lighted night. The palms along the road had been fired to illuminate the house. Black smoke from the flammables used to ignite the trees poured upward through orange flames. "It's the traitor," someone said. "The Baron will want to see you soon," another said. "I must get to the thopter," Yue thought. "I must book the ducal signet where Paul will find it," and fear struck him. "If Idahu suspects me or grows impatient, if he doesn't wait and go exactly where I told him, Jessica and Paul will not be saved from the carnage. I'll be denied even the smallest relief from my act." The Harkonnen guard released his arm, said, "Wait over there, out of the way." Abruptly, Yue saw himself as cast away in this place of destruction, spared nothing, given not the smallest pity. Idahu must not fail. Another guard bumped into him, barked, "Stay out of the way, you." "Even when they have profited by me, they despise me," Yue thought. He straightened himself as he was pushed aside, regained some of his dignity. "Wait for the Baron," a guard officer snarled. Yue nodded, walked with controlled casualness along the front of the house, turned the corner into shadows out of sight of the burning palms. Quickly, every step betraying his anxiety, Yue made for the rear yard beneath the conservatory where the Thopter waited, the craft they had placed there to carry away Paul and his mother. A guard stood at the open rear door of the house, his attention focused on the lighted hall and men banging through there, searching from room to room. How confident they were! Yue hugged the shadows, worked his way around the Thopter, eased open the door on the side away from the guard. He felt under the front seats for the Frem kit he had hidden there, lifted a flap and slipped in the ducal signet. He felt the crinkling of the spice paper there, the note he had written, pressed the ring into the paper. He removed his hand, resealed the pack. Softly, Yue closed the Thopter door, worked his way back to the corner of the house and around toward the flaming trees. "Now, it is done," he thought. Once more he emerged into the light of the blazing palms. He pulled his cloak around him, stared at the flames. "Soon I will know. Soon I will see the Baron and I will know. And the Baron, he will encounter a small tooth."